September the 17th, 1939, and the Soviets invade Poland in accordance with the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact. Poland is dismembered yet again and enters a dark age. Executions, roundups, and the deportation of millions. Another reign of terror. It's a salutary reminder of how the big powers cooperate in this region. Join me, Jan Darasz, for How We Got Here.
A number of ceremonies were held across Poland today to commemorate the 85th anniversary of the Soviet invasion at the start of World War II. The attack was part of a secret clause in the notorious Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, which divided Poland between Nazi Germany and the Soviet Union. Commemorations in the capital took place around Warsaw's monument to the fallen and murdered in the East, where Polish President Andrzej Duda laid a memorial wreath. Other events were planned nationwide, particularly in the east of the country. On September 17, 1939, the Soviet Red Army invaded Poland from the east, acting under a secret agreement with Hitler's Nazi Germany. The Treaty of Non-Aggression between Germany and the Soviet Union, commonly known as the Molotov-Ribbentrop Pact, named after the two countries' foreign ministers, contained a secret protocol outlining Berlin's and Moscow's spheres of influence across Northern Europe. As a consequence of the invasion, just over 2 weeks after German forces attacked from the west, Poland and the Baltic states were caught between two major military powers. The attack resulted in over 250,000 Polish soldiers being taken prisoner and 1.5 million civilians being deported to the USSR, mostly to Siberia and Kazakhstan. Poland's eastern borderlands were irretrievably lost, with multiple historians dubbing the event the Fourth Partition of Poland. The Soviet Union annexed all the Polish territory under its military control, with the Soviet Security Service, the NKVD, holding show elections that led to 13.5 million Poles being made Soviet citizens. A period of brutal repression ensued, including political murders, the most notorious of which was the execution of over 20,000 Polish officers, scholars and public figures in and around Katyn, Western Russia, in 1940. The Soviet occupation of Eastern Poland lasted until the summer of 1941, when Germany terminated its pact with the USSR and invaded its former ally under Operation Barbarossa. The areas taken by Germany were later recovered by the USSR and fell under their control as part of the Yalta Agreement signed in 1945 by Stalin, Churchill and Roosevelt. That region of Europe remained under the Soviet sphere of influence until the activities of the marginalized democratic opposition led to the eventual dissolution of the USSR.
I'm joined today by Dr. Paweł Ukielski, the deputy director of the Warsaw Rising Museum. Welcome to the program. The invasion, the Soviet invasion of the 17th of September 1939, was a joint invasion by with the Germans attacking 3 weeks before. Can you just sketch us in the reason behind it and the justification for it?
The first step for that invasion was, of course, Hitler-Stalin Pact or Ribbentrop-Molotov, as some name it, with a secret protocol where they divided spheres of influence of two powers, two totalitarian powers in Central Europe. Germany and Soviet Union decided to divide Central Europe between them. And Poland was the main point of that. Hitler attacked Poland on 1st of September, and then he was still pushing Stalin to fulfill his part of the agreement. Stalin was more careful about that, but as he got the information that the Western powers would not intervene against Germany, he decided to fulfill his part of this agreement. On 17 September, Soviet army entered Polish territory. In fact, dividing, it was the fourth partition of Poland, dividing Poland with Germany into more or less two halves of occupied territories.
And given the fact that some Polish planners, at least strategists, knew of the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact, did this come as a more or less a total surprise to the Polish command?
Well, it was probably not the total surprise, but definitely it was surprised, especially for the society. And the authorities decided to evacuate. They were arrested in Romania after evacuation, but still they managed to pass the power to the newly constructed government in exile, thus having this legitimacy of Polish authorities abroad throughout the whole period of the Second World War.
The character of the Soviet occupation was every bit as brutal as that of the German occupation. Could you sketch us in the justification? It was to ostensibly defend Belarusians and Ukrainians, Western Ukrainians, against the evil Poles. Was this the more or less
the first
accurate
justification of Soviet invasion? Was that Polish state ceased to exist, and therefore Soviet Red Army could enter these territories to protect people, to protect those territories from being occupied by Germany as well, and of course to protect especially Belarusians, Ukrainians, not only from Poles but also from Germans, and very quickly those territories were incorporated using formal methods by the Soviet Union.
So they were formally incorporated into the USSR as separate republics?
No, they were incorporated as a part, western part of Belarusian Republic, Soviet Republic, and Ukrainian Soviet Republic. So, in fact, based on that, which was later on, after the German attack on Soviet Union, also accepted by the Western powers. In Tehran they decided, and finally in Yalta they decided, that those territories will be part of Soviet Union also after the war.
And this was just because the Soviet Union was too important an ally against Germany not to give any concessions?
Of course, but we have to remember that Soviet Union became ally of the Western powers just in 1941. In 1939 they were allies of Germany. Therefore it is quite important to understand the Second World War, but also the Cold War afterwards, that during the Second World War there were at least three sides with different goals to achieve. There were Nazi Germany, there were Soviet Union, and the Western powers. And first 2 years, two totalitarian regimes, Germany and Soviet Union, were allies. And after German attack on the Soviet Union, the system of alliances changed. But the Western powers paid very big price for that, because they became allies of the Soviet Union, but after the war they had to pay the price of the whole Central Europe that came into Soviet sphere of influence. Not only those territories straight incorporated into Soviet Union, but also formerly independent states like Poland, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Romania, etc., etc. So this is this beginning of Second World War is also explanation for what happened afterwards.
How is the historiography of the events that followed the 17th of September, the Soviet invasion, how is that portrayed in Soviet historiography, Polish history, post-war history, and the Western history? It seems to me that the whole of 1939, from September the 1st, was dismissed in a few lines, a few paragraphs, and the enormity of the of the deportations, for example, a couple of million Poles were sent off to Siberia. The suffering that was caused on this territory of Poland was sort of swept under the carpet because of these Cold War reasons, as you suggested.
Yes, of course. In Soviet historiography, it was the liberation of Western Ukraine and Western Belarus. Of course, deportations were forgotten. Both Polish communist historiography could not write about it. Definitely Soviet did not write about it. And in the West, the topic was not very interesting or important. We have to remember that we had also anti-Polish action before the war on the territory of the Soviet Union. Dozens of thousands of Poles were killed and hundreds of thousands of them were deported. So this was everything for years forgotten. Now, of course, we have opportunity to speak about this openly, but after decades of silencing of the topic, the mainstream narrative line about the history of Second World War was settled for, and this is not easy to make significant changes for that. And even though we had Cold War, still in the West, Soviet Union was perceived as an ally, for the time of Second World War.
Yes, I remember reading history books and magazines when I was a kid growing up in the UK that the chief perpetrator of the Katyn Forest massacre was the Germans.
Yes, and for Polish history in the Second World War, it was quite also important, a kind of turning point, because after German invasion on Soviet Union, Polish-Soviet relations, official diplomatic relations, yes, were re-established. But they were again broken after Germans discovered graves and Polish government in exile demanded explanations. Stalin said, well, you believe German propaganda. So they broke the relations with the Polish government in exile, which was crucial as the Red Army was entering Poland or liberating Poland from Nazi occupation. So the allies of our allies, the Western powers, were not only not our allies, but also not sustaining even the diplomatic relations with Poland.
Yes, as you mentioned, it's the Polish Rising Museum, which is a Norman Davis, great Polish historian, his phrase. And in his book about the Warsaw Rising, he describes this, the difficulty of Poland being an ally of the Western powers and yet an enemy of one of the allies of the great alliance.
Exactly. We have also, Stalin had his personal attitude towards Poland, because in the Polish Bolshevik War in 1920, because of his decisions, Soviets lost the war.
Yes, he held back, didn't he?
Exactly. His forces. So his hatred towards Poland as a state and Poles as nation was even greater than in case of other Soviet leaders.
Is this attitude towards Poles and Poland repeated in modern day Russian historiography?
Well, Russian historiography always paid great attention to Poland, because Poles were, even before the Soviet Union times, Poles were perceived as traitors of Slavic people, etc., etc. So Soviets or Russians always wanted to expand their territory. Poles were always an obstacle for that, and there were huge debates whether incorporate Poland or what to do with this. So definitely, if we see today's propaganda in Russia, Poles are, of course, they are presented as American puppets, but also as traitors of Slavic people, as a great enemy of Russia, and that's why maybe not Putin himself, but for example, Medvedev always says that after we finish with Ukraine, other states like Poland are in the role.
My final question to you, Dr. Ukielski, it's one of these very disheartening, dispiriting shows of great power cooperation, certainly in Eastern Europe. What the key relationship is that between Germany and Russia. We've seen them cooperate, whatever their enmity is like. They've gone to war, but they've also cooperated in dividing up the territory of Eastern Europe between them, ever since the partitions of Poland in the 18th century. This is a constant feature of our region.
Yes, it was a constant feature of our region, and definitely, fortunately now, German-Russian cooperation was not based on division of territories, but they still did so, even though the Germans, who are our allies today, we are allies in NATO, we are together in European Union, so they are our allies, but still, they did not pay attention to those warnings they had from Poland, from Baltic states, from Romania, that Putin is dangerous and that Russia would like to restore their imperial power. And they did not listen to those warnings. They decided to cooperate, and they believed that with economy they could change Russia. Russia presented that it was impossible 2 years ago, but in fact they presented it since at least 2007 and famous Putin's speech.
Yes, and I suppose also we must remember that the countries, like you said, parts of Romania, the Baltic states, they are victims of this Russian imperialism that started on the 17th of, or the one of the iterations of Russian imperialism that started on the 17th of September. Thank you very much, Dr. Ukielski, for coming on to the programme. Great to have you.
Thank you.
So, that's all we have time for today. Once more, do join us next time for How We Got Here.